So, small group last morning. Any questions this morning? Yes.
Rumaz, in your answer to the question of the devotee from the Prague about experience in bhakti, you mentioned that ultimately the bhakti is the exercise of the heart.
Bhakti is an exercise of the heart?
Ultimately, yeah. Mm-hmm. And it seems that this is something different from the angas of bhakti, which we are already performed in sadhana. This yoga exercise. Heart exercise.
The heart exercise is not mentioned as one of the angas, is that what you mean?
Yeah, because we are already performing. Because you said to him that this is hardest things to do, this heart exercise. So it seems that this is something different from Agas and Bhakti, from sadhana, because we are already doing this. So what do you mean by this?
Already doing what?
By the heart exercise.
What are we already doing?
Sadhana and Agas and Bhakti.
Okay, well, the point is this, that you have, for example, Swarup Siddha Bhakti, angas of bhakti, like hearing about Krishna, chanting, arching, seeing the deity, serving the deity, for example. These are powerful forms of Swarup Siddha Bhakti that are inherently constituted of bhakti, Krishna's Swarup Shakti. They don't come from anywhere else, right? Except from the realm of Krishna. Now, they manifest on the senses of devotees in sadhana bhakti. In sadhana bhakti, then there's action of the senses, and comparatively, the emotive component of bhakti is not present. When we enter into bhava bhakti, then the emotive element and the active are both present, so this is bhakti proper. Sadhana bhakti is more or less apprenticeship, so one goes through the motions with the senses, but the emotions, feeling, bhava, is not present to the same degree. There are shadow of it, there are some feelings and so forth, but so what we mean then by the exercise of the heart, obviously that's a kind of a metaphoric statement, because it has nothing to do with pumping the physical heart or anything like that. It's not aerobics or something like that. So what we mean by that is that in another sense, bhakti constitutes two things: mercy and effort. So, for example, classic example is Mother Yashoda, who tried to bind Krishna, and she made a great effort. She was perspiring, and seeing her effort, which was really out of concern that he might run away, more than to chastise him at that point. She had already chastised him, and now he was running away. And then she said, oh my God, he's going to run away. So she tried to capture him and tie him up. So she wanted to keep him. And and she made the effort, and it resulted in his mercy. So he had the two things. mercy and effort. So bhakti comes to us as an opportunity. Even when we're not looking for bhakti, perhaps, we may even engage in bhakti, so to speak, without any effort, without even knowing we're doing it. You hear the devotees chanting, for example. Or you, someone gives you mahaprasada, right? So that'll have power, because the srupsita bhakti is inherent in bhakti, so it's like fire. If you touch it, you get burned, whether you think you will or not, right? So, that said, we're also told about these types of bhakti and the power of that type of bhakti to inspire us. Point being that if the rat in the famous Puranic story could, when trying to drink the ghee on the altar and got one of the wicks stuck on his nose on fire, and he went like this, and Krishna accepted it as archana, and then he died, he went to Vaikuntha, something like that. So, if bhakti has that kind of power, then what to speak if we make an effort to take advantage of bhakti? So, by the mercy of bhakti, you know, out of the mercy of a devotee who has bhakti, bhakti is shared with us. But then, the rate typically at which we will progress is relative to how much we also make an effort to take advantage of the mercy. Sometimes I say that the effort in bhakti is to get grace. So what I mean by that, there's effort is there, but effort is different in bhakti than it is in yoga or in dhyana, which is really entirely effort-based. We're making an effort in relation to mercy that's been extended to us, and the effort is to embrace it and take advantage of it and apply ourselves. So the jiva does have a will. We're not just a stone. And so we can respond to things that happen to us. So when bhakti happens to us, how we respond to it, that's going to determine, in one sense, the rate at which we progress. So, yes, I mean, you can be touched by bhakti and have made no effort and get some bhakti some scar, and that's good for you, and so on and so forth. But let's look at, you know, at, for example, Sharanagati. There's some effort in Sharanagati. You were talking about the first limb or division of Sharanagati, pratikul, anukul. So, accepting things that are favorable, rejecting things that are unfavorable, that's not just going to happen to you if you just sit there like a stone, right? You have to consciously make an effort to accept what's favorable and reject what's unfavorable. So this is, there's an effort there, there's a commitment and so forth. So there's something, in other words, from our side, which is our response to bhakti, and I have sometimes described it in that way, as an exercise of our heart, so it's the giving of yourself, in response to bhakti. So it's kind of an equation. Does that make sense to you? Does that answer your question, or is that create more questions?
Yeah. I thought that it is also something to do with our motivation, which by which we are doing certain things in bhakti. Yeah? That we are, that works on the heart, that means to look deeply what is in our heart. Because Krishna is ultimately Bhava Grahajana. So this is actually work on the heart. I felt in that way.
Yeah, well, motive is the same thing. I mean, effort, motive, we make a... yeah, it's very related, similar. If your heart's in the right place, then you're going to give yourself more fully. If your heart's somewhere else, then you're not going to make the same effort, and so forth. And when we use the heart as a metaphor, it's kind of like, if the heart stops, you're finished. The brain could stop, you could continue on, but so the heart's like center that metaphorically speaks about everything, so completely giving yourself. So it really kind of speaking about the mood of Sharanagata. So Krishna tells him, Gita, here's bhakti, I love you, here, please do it. Manmanabhava manbhakto manjajama mimusuru sarvadharma mantrajama. So he says, become my devotee, and how to do it. So empty your heart of anything else, be only in there, give yourself to me. There could be different motives under the modes of influence of the modes of nature. Someone could engage in bhakti, predominated by a mood that created by or fostered by tamaguna, rajaguna, sattvaguna, and so forth. Also, so that you could maybe look at that as motive issues, so forth. So, yeah, I mean, it's effort, motive, if you, also what I meant by that is that, you know, you could go through the hearing and chanting, but your heart can be somewhere else. It can be beating for the chanting to end. So that you can go and do something else that you want to. Well, if you do the chanting like that, then you're not going to get the nectar, the taste from it that's there. So your heart has to beat with this mantra, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna. And then you got to do other things automatically. But your heart is beating for that. And then when those things, duties, other responsibilities are done, then you're just waiting for that. And when you're doing that, it's not beating for something else. That's the idea. To help, yeah. Okay. So you can see that's a good practical advice. Because you laugh because you know, yeah, I chant and my heart's beating for something else, and then you can understand why you're not making any progress. I've been doing this long. I'm not making any progress. What have you been doing? What's your heart beating for? Right. So that's the art, the skill of sadhana. So sadhana is a work, work in progress. It takes time. It's heart surgery. What else? Yes. How have you been?
Good. I'm so I have a question, Maharaj, because you mentioned about Rajas. Love in Braj.
About what?
Love in Braj.
Love in Braj.
Prem, bhakti in Braj.
Yeah.
And I remember you told us that, well, it's sometimes, it's not, because I was wondering, because there is a lot of verses that saying that devotee should please Krishna. Like us, and do everything to please Krishna. But I notice in Braj, it's not, it looks like not everything is about pleasing Krishna. Sometimes Krishna is not happy. So why there are so many verses to please Krishna, then automatically it's not gonna be only about pleasing him, or
yeah.
When he's not happy, it's also pleasing him? How does work.
Maharaj wspomniał na wykładzie o miłości, która ma miejsce w prawie. Natomiast kilka dawno zauważyła, iż jest wiele wersetów wskazujących na to, że wysiłki w Licili są skoncentrowane na zadowoleniu Kryszny. Natomiast Kryszna bywa niezadowolony w Bradży. Kryszna w Bradży bywa również niezadowolony. Więc czy to jego niezadowolenie jest również zadowolenie Kryszny? Jak te rzeczy pogodzić?
So in the sadhaka, then, to please Krishna, there are things that we could do that wouldn't be pleasing to Krishna, that are not favorable for bhakti, then there are things that are favorable for bhakti. So we're taught to do things that are pleasing for Krishna. Bhakti itself is defined by Goswami as anukul. Anukul means it's favorable, pleasing to Krishna, acts that are pleasing to Krishna, right? And we're informed about that because we're in a realm where there are acts that are not pleasing to Krishna, and sometimes we do them. When we come from that realm, we're trying to go to another realm where things are only pleasing to Krishna. But it's confusing because, as you say, when we look at the realm, at least on the surface, it appears like some things there are not pleasing to Krishna. It's something like this. In the material world, there's happiness and distress, right? Happiness and distress. Am I right?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Yes.
You sure?
Not all being distressed. Yes.
She's right. What is our happiness in this world? Happiness comes from our attachments. We're attached to things, and if we can get them, we feel happy. If I can get a partner, if I can get some money, and my happiness is dependent upon acquisition. I'm just speaking about it in a general way. But the Gita teaches that attachment is the womb from which suffering is born, because you can't keep anything. So Krishna tells Arjuna that this world is characterized by dukkha. Dukkalayam, misery, suffering. And Arjuna says, well, I kind of like it. You call it suffering, but some things I like. And Krishna says, ashashvatam. Well, you can't keep it. So if you like it, but you can't keep it, then if you look at it from a larger lens, it's really suffering. If you said, I really like this, and I tell you, you can't keep it. And that's the very nature of your happiness, is that it's actually breeding ground for distress. So it looks like there's happiness in the world, but really, it's all ignorance. Attachment is ignorance, and ignorance is causes bondage. And unhappiness. Let me ask you another way. Is there happiness in jail? So Similarly, in the spiritual world, in Goloka, let's say, which is what you're asking about, in the Braj, is there happiness and distress there? Looks like it, right? Sometimes gopis are crying. Sometimes Mother Yasoda is crying, oh, Krishna's gone before us. He won't be back. He might not come back. Something might happen. Sometimes Krishna is disappointed. He cannot get Radha's attention, right? But just like in material life, there's no real happiness, there's no real suffering. So even this apparent suffering is a source of happiness. The devotees only want to please Krishna. Whatever pleases him makes them happy. Even if it means separation from him, still there's bliss in the separation. And so it's a leela, it's a drama. It's another way to look at it. In a drama, there are the bad guys and the good guys. But it's just a drama, right? There's no real bad guys in there. So there's no real suffering in Krishna Leela. There's only an appearance of such. And the best example, or the closest thing to actual suffering is separation from Krishna. But it's said to make the heart grow fonder. The gopis lost Krishna's company in the Rasa Leela after risking everything to meet him at night, and then he disappeared. And so, in their separation from him, they were suffering. But Krishna told them, I disappeared because I knew that in separation from me, your love would grow fonder. He gave the example that if you have something, let's say, some valuable thing, is a valuable thing. Its real value is known and felt and appreciated when you lose it. Oh. It's said in union between the devotee and Krishna, there is one Krishna. In separation from Krishna, there are millions of Krishnas. Everywhere you look, everything reminding you of Krishna. I see him in that, I see him in that, I see him in that. So, if anything, the separation and apparent distress is actually happiness accentuated. Again, this is right on the climax of the Krishna Leela. Krishna disappears from the gopis. And then their love just increases. And then he goes, oh my gosh, holy cow, he says, what kind of love is that? I have to taste that. What they're experiencing, that is the birth of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. There's a saying in Chaitanya Charitamrita, Paya Visha Jala Hoye Vidare Anandam. Krishna Premaya Adbhuta Charita Bhaya Visha Jala Hoye Vidare Anandamaya Krishna Premaya Adbhuta Charita. The Adbhuta Charita, the wonderful, astonishing character of Prema, is that on the outside it looks like poison, like suffering, but bhaya bhisha jala hoy bitare anandamoy, but on the inside it's full of ananda. This is the astonishing characteristic of prema. Material life is just the opposite. It looks good on the outside if your material life is successful, but on the inside, it's actually suffering. At least suffering in progress. So, that said, there's a difference between sadhana and sadhana bhakti and prema bhakti. Again, in sadhana bhakti, then you have the opportunity to do things that are favorable to Krishna, but you're also faced with the opportunity to do things that are not favorable to Krishna. So you have to choose things that are favorable for Krishna, right? All the time. But in rasa, there's no such choice because the environment there is not the material Maya Shakti. The environment is Krishna's Swarup Shakti. And Krishna's Swarup Shakti is existing only for the purpose of pleasing Krishna in newer and newer and more nuanced ways. So there's no opportunity to displease Krishna. Bhakti has now become mature. But the way in which that mature bhakti, prema bhakti, expresses itself is in the context of the drama of the lila. So, there are apparent problems. There's a huge problem for Vatsalya Rasa because all the mothers of all the gopis want their daughters to marry Krishna. But according to Krishna's astrological chart, it's not a good idea because he's going to go away to a distant city. So they're suffering from this. But this is part of the makeup of Parakiya, right? Which gives Krishna so much pleasure, so you have to look at the whole picture. Madhurya Rasa, Vatsalya Rasa, Sakya Rasa, these are completely pleasing to Krishna, but they're fully expressions of motherhood, friendship, and romance. And so, and that's why they're pleasing, because he really is the son of Mother Yasoda. She really is his mother. And she really is expressing motherhood for him. And in the context of expressing motherhood, mothers have to chastise their children. It's just like part of it. If there was never any, that aspect wasn't there, it would be like, it's not really motherhood, something like that. So they're full expressions of these things that are Krishna-centered, that have all the elements, all the ingredients of such, of motherhood, of friendship, of romantic life, and so forth, but all centered on Krishna. And all the negatives, even, are also positives. So, the motive, you're talking about motive, the motive of everyone is to please Krishna. But it plays out in different ways in the context of the drama. One man in this world comes before the deity of Krishna. Swami is giving a discourse on the Bhagavad Gita. Many Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis are present. And Mr. Patel comes in. He steps over people. He ignores the speaker. He goes up in front of the deity and he pulls out a flower. And then he, Ryan, Krishna, and makes an offering. Well, I'm just depicting a classical Nishtadikari. but anyway, he makes an offering to Krishna. He offers the flower. Other than stepping over everybody and ignoring the Vaishnava discourse, I mean, it looks like he's making a nice offering to Krishna, right? He's not interested in anybody else, only Krishna, not the Vaishnava, not doesn't want to hear anything, any talk, any philosophy, just wants to offer a prayer to Krishna. How pure. So he takes his flower, he offers it to Krishna, and then he reaches in his pocket, in his wallet, and he puts one paisa. It looks like there's so many bills here. Don't have any change. Puts it in there. And so he makes the offering. But anyway, in his heart, he's making the offering, but in his heart he wants something material. He wants to have to get a new wife or something. Bring to Krishna. So that's not cool. It may look like when he's making the offering and saying the prayer. Meanwhile, Mother Yashoda is tying him up. That looks the opposite. Krishna must be, how could Krishna be pleased? He's crying. He's obviously not pleased. Bring that man. Get rid of Yashoda. Bring Mr. Patel here. Mr. Patel knows how to please Krishna. Mother Yashoda, she's tying him up and he's crying. So this is not to understand the nature of the Leela and how it plays itself out fully with regard to friendship, romance, and maternal or parental love, but with motive only to please Krishna. Again, she's tying him up because she's afraid he might run away and she wants to keep him there. And that man doesn't want Krishna, he wants a new wife. He's paying for it too. Not much. You understand? Does that help?
Because he really goes through it, Krishna. Because I know one of the Goswamis, I don't know who wrote that, Krishna, he doesn't pretend. He really goes through crying, suffering, and it's real. It's real. But at the same time, it's pleasing him. So he draws from that other stuff and I try to understand what he draws from that situation, like Yashoda's love or something. Even if he's crying, he's happy. That's what it is.
Yeah, even if he's crying, it's blissful. It's a form of bliss. It's an expression of bliss, which is nuanced. So there are many different nuanced expressions of such. But everything about Bhaktisarala Rasa, everything about Bhakti Rasa is pleasing to Krishna. Yes, he really suffers in the Leela, but there's no suffering. So, you know, maybe I've given this example before, maybe this will help. Somebody asked me once that, Swami, in Krishna Leela, is there any real sex life? That was his question. You know what I mean? You know, any real sex life? So I said, no, you understand, in the material world, there's no real sex life. So here we only have this semblance of things that we try to relate to what goes on there from here, but it's not, you know, apples to apples, something like that. So again, in order to illustrate that, I say everything here is suffering, really. Everything there is joy. But it does play itself out like that. He does cry. He does feel afraid that his mother's chasing him, and so forth. Their love causes his omniscience to go to the background. And what it caused, I mean, the only reason she's chasing him is because she loves him, right? The only reason Radha won't let him come into her house is because she loves him. And it's just a way in which that love is expressed. She's upset with him because she heard that he had a meeting with Chandravali. If she didn't love him, she wouldn't care. So it was Chandravali, who cares? But because she loves him, she cares. So, she's mad at him, that's an expression of her love for him. He feels that she's mad and he has to suffer the consequences, but he's also feeling her love, so it's pleasing to him. So, but I suggest you go there and find out. Yes?
According to Abhinava Gupta, the aesthetic feelings are different from what we experience in so-called real life, material life, because it's like on the stage, you see someone crying, or you see even something ugly from a material perspective, but within the realm of art, it is still beautiful in some way. What do you think about this concept, and how does it correspond to the idea of spiritual world and emotions there?
Well, like I said, it's a drama, right?
Mówi o czymś takim, że to, czego doświadczamy na poziomie estetycznym, na przykład tak jak na scenie, aktor odgrywa swoją rolę, płacze, jest tam rozpacz, czasami coś strasznego się dzieje, czasami coś bardzo brzydkiego, ale z estetycznego punktu widzenia, ponieważ jest to sztuka, jest to wszystko piękne. I z tego czerpie się też jakąś przyjemność, oglądając to, nawet jeśli są jakieś straszne sceny, jest to rodzaj przyjemności, kiedy się to ogląda. Czy w jaki sposób to można porównać do tego, do platformy duchowej?
So Abhinava Gupta is a secular author of Ras Shastra, or Indian aesthetic theory in poetry, drama, and the arts, and so forth. And Rupa Goswami took that secular Ras Shastra from Bharata, Vishwanath, not Vishwanath Chakravartin, another Vishwanath, Abhinava Gupta, and so forth, and then he used that structure to explain Krishna Lila and Bhakti Rasa. And so the question is about the idea that when the drama is performed, or let's say you're in a movie and you're watching a movie, you're sitting in a chair, but you are transported into the emotions of the movie, and relative to the discussion, I guess, there are sad emotions in the movie that you can experience also. You're in your chair, you're kind of transported there, and you're experiencing the melancholy or the distress, and but it's one step removed from your present reality. You're now in the realm of art, and so it's not really distressful in the same way as if you actually felt that outside of the theater personally and experienced it. You're experiencing it in a way that has transported you beyond the realm of your immediate experience. And so you're in the realm of art, and in the realm of art, even the sadness has some beauty and some value and happiness to it. And so what you're talking about, right? So it helps to explain the point. So of course, amongst such secular Ras theorists, aestheticians or whatever in India, the idea was that you were transported from your immediate situation, which is bodily and mental identification, into this realm of the arts, which is like the upper realm of material existence. It's very subtle and refined. And if you have a sympathetic heart for the arts, then you can hear the symphony, you can go to the opera, and the drama, and you're there, beyond your immediate situation, and this transportation that takes place, that takes you there, is their idea of something like Brahman. You've gone beyond the body-mind conditioning, and so you get a semblance of the taste of Brahman. That's how they talk about it. Some people say, what did I have an example from the Siddhartha that he showed me the other day. But so that's the theory. Of course, Rupa Goswami's theory is about bhakti rasa, but we see the parallels here. So now it's bhakti rasa. It's not in, this is or, these are ordinary dramas. Like, what's his name? You know, like Kalidas, great poet. Maybe anybody who has some sympathetic heart for the arts, you know, you can understand what we're talking about. It's like, you've gone. But Mahaprabhu said, Nadanam Nadanam Nasundaram Kovitam Ma. So he's saying, don't mistake the transporting kind of effect of the arts, this very refined, cultured sensibilities, and how it removes you to some extent from everyday life. Don't conflate that with bhakti. He says, bhakti is nadanam, no interested in wealth, nadanam, nadanam, no followers, sundaram, opposite sex, nadanam, nadanam, sundaram, kavitam va. Kavitam va means va, or the arts, only. This is us, sattva guna. The more you go in sattva guna, the more there's a happiness in sattva guna. Sattva guna is characterized by happiness. The jnanis go to a very, very refined state of sattva guna. In a very refined state of sattva guna, you can know what it means to be an atma. That doesn't mean you have brahmananda, you haven't entered into brahman, but you can be like jivanmukta, something like that. So there's happiness in sattva guna, if there's any happiness in the material world. Right. So anyway, so Rupa Goswami is, you know, playing on that to some extent, and that whole theory. But the drama now is Krishna Leela, and by hearing about Krishna, you get transported into the Leela, and you this is higher stages of bhakti, in bhava bhakti, and you transported, and you experience it, come out, and go back in. Rather than experiencing Brahman, you experience Dasya Sakya. So, does that help? Yes.
Maharaj, I've got a question about experiencing Krishna in the spiritual world. Like, it is said that, for example, gopis during the rasa dance, each of them feels that Krishna is with them.
He did what?
Gopis in rasa dance, they feel that each of them feels that Krishna is with her.
Yeah.
And the same, like, his friends, when they eat lunch, each of them feels that Krishna is by his side. But then we've got manjaris, or on the gopa side, we have also some assistants of the direct threats, and I was wondering how they experience Krishna, his indirect experience of Krishna, or somehow they also feel that Krishna is focusing on them. Moje pytanie jest takie, że jest opisane, że kiedy gopi tańczą z Krishną, każda z nich czuje, że Krishna tańczy z nią, albo kiedy chłopcy pasterze jedzą z nim lunch, to każdy z nich czuje, że Krishna jest właśnie z nim. Ale mamy na przykład manjari, które są służkami, które nie mają bezpośredniego kontaktu z Krishną, albo chłopcy, pasterze, którzy są asystentami tych bezpośrednich przyjaciół, i zastanawiam się, jak oni odczuwają obecność Krishny.
They experience the same bhav by identification with the bhav. So, for example, the handmaidens of Radha or other gopi group leaders, their handmaidens experience their bhava, so it's indirect in one sense. But the experience is no different. So they experience the bhava. And in the context of their position in the lila, they may have direct service to Krishna also at times. But the Manjari example is a good one because it speaks about serving the it's like it's gopi bhav in the context of serving the gopis. If you study the commentaries, you find that the Manjaris are also there in Rasa Leela. But yeah, they're not dancing with Krishna in the same way. But the dancing that he's doing, they're experiencing nonetheless by way of being fully identified with and serving the bhav of those that are. Does that help?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
In Chaitanya Leela, many of the prominent kirtan pastimes take place on the island where Mayapur is. I can't remember if it's Antadulu, but that island. So like Srivas kirtans and Kazi, you know, that kind of thing. But yesterday in your reading, we were talking about Godrumdweep and how Godrumdweep represents kirtan. So I was wondering why Godrumdweep over Mayapur, Antadulu.
Antadweep is what Antani Vedan. I don't know who it was, but it may have been Bhaktivinoda who made that determination of the different islands, of not the nine islands of Antadweep and how they correspond with the different angas of bhakti. But it's they correspond with different angas of bhakti, and they correspond also with different different places in the Braj Leela. But the way those places in the Braj Leela manifest in Navadweep, it's like scattered. Why is this over here? And why is Govardhan over there? And so sometimes the answer is because when Vrajalila comes here, it gets a little mixed up because, after all, Krishna's not trying to become Radha and everything's turned around backwards and so on. So that's something about why there's not more like kind of geographical sense the way there is in Braj, where everything is and why it doesn't play out exactly the same. But I'm not answering your question. So, and as I say, I don't know of anywhere else that has been described other than by the Bhaktivinoda. Now that you bring it to my attention, the identification of the different islands with different angas of Navalakshan, Bhakti, Shravana, Kirtan, Vishnu Swami, there are nine of them. So I would have to think about that, and I would like to see if there's an earlier reference for one, and secondarily, then if not, if Bhaktivinoda ever gives any reasoning for that, per se, and I can't recall hearing that previously, so I can't give a satisfactory answer to your question. Is that satisfactory? And Ritu Dweep is identified with Sakyarasa. Why isn't Godrum? That was a question I had, but I never had the time to look it up. Sajjan came, but in Goa Drum is Nandagram. So that is a famous place in the Braj, identified with Sakya Rasa. Also the what else is there? Sarabi Kao, corresponds with the coronation of Krishna as the king of Braj. Maybe it's all scattered there, but yeah, I have to look that up. I'll look into it. But you know, I must add something. Make that kind of determination. I think Antadeva is in like in the center. So you have Atmanivedana. And then surrender, self-surrender. Other Amas, yeah. Some of the point now?
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay. Yes.
Guru Maharshi spoke one day about principles and details.
About principles and details.
Could you give us some definition, because I see that many devotees mix them together.
So what do you want from me?
Just tell us some definition. What is the principles and details? Because
but there are many, many details.
But because I see that it's quite important and devotees mix them together.
Yeah, that's a big problem. Details are things that may be invoked for time and circumstance in order to bring home, so to speak, to the student, the principal. So, for example, there's a principle that one should chant the holy name, japa. The detail is how many times. So we find Mahaprabhu said at least 1 lakh, and Prabhupada wanted his disciples to chant 64 rounds. He said 32, then he decided 16. Bhaktisiddhanta said at least 4. And don't let them all starve. So those are details. So, one way, let's say, what makes one eligible for bhakti? Faith in bhakti, that's all. Now the guru may add other things on there and say, to initiate you, I want you to do this, this, and this, and the other one may say, those are details. Mm-hmm. So there are many details, and they're distinguished from principles in that they're relative. So I can't list them all. Whatever, there could be new details.
What about some philosophical differences between some sanghas?
Philosophical differences. Yes. Well, that's a little bit. There can be different correct interpretations of some sections of scripture, and then there can be wrong ones and right ones. So we have one philosophy, but it's a little bit flexible. And it could be interpreted correctly in a couple of ways, but then there are interpretations that are distortions, that are incorrect as well. So for that, we need a guide. You have to ask me on an ongoing basis. Is this a detail or a principle? Then I can answer you. But or is this philosophically it just a nuanced? Different but correct answer, or is it a wrong answer? There also might be right answers philosophically that are wrong, because because the guru wants the disciples to think in a certain way, and he knows that that will be for their benefit at this time, so he instructs them in that way, even philosophically. While that answer may not be entirely, in all circumstances, philosophically correct. So, let's say, you know, we see this, for example, someone may say that Hare in the Hare Krishna mantra, it means Hara, Radha. And someone else may say, you know, no, it doesn't mean that. It means Hari, it means Krishna. So both could be right. So those are opposite answers, but both could be right relative to the sentiment. Someone else may say, no, Ram means Ramchandra. Someone else may say, Ram means Balaram. Someone else may say, Ram means Krishna, rather than Ram, for example. So they're all, those are all right answers. Depending on the circumstances, and so forth. But then the correct answer is that they're all wrong, because the correct answer is that they're all right. I think that there are certain distortions of the philosophy that do make render a sect questionable if that sect is instituting those incorrect that incorrect understanding and making it part of their doctrine and so forth. And we find Bhaktivinoda Thakur singled out certain sects at his time that had done that and referred to them as deviant, opposite, and so forth. So you take like one group that's prominent in the world. They have some of my ideas. Let's say there's a group, and it says that people fall from, so Jesus fall from Goloka Vrindavan. I mean, let's just pretend that there's a group that does, that teaches that. Okay, that's wrong. And they say, well, their teacher taught it. But let's say he said it one time, but he said otherwise at other times. And if you look carefully, you realize he's saying it for effect, but the real teaching is they don't fall, and that's what he's consistently teaching. So that, let's say they consistently teach in the group that you do fall. Still, it's a big group, and a lot of people don't believe it. They don't subscribe to that. So then, you know, it's hard to just render it completely wrong, because everybody in the group doesn't even accept that. If everybody accepted it entirely, then you might say, they're on it, forget them. But is that follow? Yeah, so. But I mean, if there's a major point in philosophy that's a deviation that can't be shown to be something like a preaching strategy temporarily or something like that, then you have to characterize the group as being, you know, another religion or something like that. Yes?
Yeah, what about four regulative principles?
Yeah, those are not principles, those are details. And proper just use the word principle.
Yeah.
It's not a principle.
It can be misleading.
Yeah, those are not. The four regulative principles are details that a guru could invoke or not as a criterion that he would like to see in place before someone is initiated. principle is there in Vajra Samhita Sindhu. The question there is, what is the adhikar for treading the path of bhakti? And treading the path of bhakti for those who are eligible begins with what? No, what does it begin with? If you have faith, right, and you have eligibility to engage in bhakti, so what's the first? Yeah, guru. The guru parashraya. Take shelter of the guru. And in the context of taking shelter of the guru, there's initiation, diksha. So the qualification then is faith. That's the principle. Now you could add something there that you want to initiate them after you see this and have some Buddhist charger, even though the name doesn't depend upon such that you're going to give. But, so those are details. Even the interpretation of them, they're from the Bhagavatam, right? Raj Pariksit Maharaj was told, these are the places where you can find Kali Yuga, wherever there is intoxication, gambling, animal, himsa, violence, and street. So these things could be interpreted even the words in different ways. Some people would interpret street as no prostitution. Don't be a prostitute. Don't go to a prostitute. Follow that. So, or if you don't, then call you. Or someone could say, it says straight means women, so you can't have a woman in your life. But that would be given the whole teaching, that would be a wrong interpretation. Prabhupada interpreted it in two ways. He said, once you have sexual intimacy only with a married partner for procreation. And then sometimes he said, you should have sexual intimacy with a married partner, only with a married partner, not another one, not somebody else. So he gave two interpretations of that, for example. So even the regulative principles could be interpreted differently. But they're not principles, they're details. So even the interpretations are further details. So, and they're good, this is a good idea, and so forth. But the principle is, we learn from Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, that what character, what makes one eligible for treading the path of bhakti, which begins with taking shelter of the guru and receiving initiation, is faith. And therefore we find, for example, Bhakti Notsong, not to open a marketplace, he's selling the holy name for faith. He's not asking, did you follow the regulative details? There's some idea that develops that by doing something else, let me give you an example. Ahimsa is not an anga of bhakti. Right? So how can you do ahimsa, which would mean, for example, no meat eating would be an expression of ahimsa, right? How can you do ahimsa and get bhakti? How can ahimsa qualify you for bhakti? So it becomes a problem when these things, for example, ahimsa, which would be one of the regulative details, is thought to qualify one for bhakti. And then you've got this idea that something else you have to do to qualify yourself to get bhakti, but nothing can qualify you more than bhakti herself. And all you need in order to take advantage of that qualifying agency is faith in her ability to qualify you. That's the generosity of bhakti, and that's the power of bhakti. If you want to have pursue jnana, then you do need other things. You need a clean heart, for example. You don't need a clean heart to take up bhakti, and there's nothing that can clean your heart more comprehensively than bhakti. So if we require something more than faith, and we think that something more than faith in bhakti is required to qualify someone for bhakti, then we're minimizing the power and virtue and efficacy of bhakti herself. That said, I mean, any guru is certainly able to ask disciples to conduct themselves in certain ways before he initiates them. But this is the principle. If faith is not there and they're following the principles, then the details, then that's not going to be something missing significantly in the equation. Is that, yes.
Would you consider also to recommend those words which weren't completely addressed directly to devotees, but to outsiders, to Vaishnava world, like Vaishnava Siddhanta Mala by Bhaktivinoda Thakur, as kind of abbreviated foundation of philosophical basics for any Vaishnava to know, as also part because Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, without the proper guidance, might be also a bit, hard to study itself, because it's a very detailed, precise description, and as a handbook, it might be a bit, it requires some good guidance. But those works, as I mentioned, like Vaishnava Siddhanta Mala, are really clear way of understanding the basics, like really ABC.
Or Madhurika Dambani?
Of course, but I'm talking in general about this Vaishnava Siddhanta Mala is not so well known and read as Madhurika Dambani, at least from my perspective when I speak with other devotees.
So, what's your question? Of course, it's a good book, yeah.
Yeah. Just to recommend to read it, yeah.
Yeah.
I will translate it into Polish. Zapytałem Maharaja, bo Rasana pyta o to, czym są jak gdyby podstawowe zasady, jakieś takie podstawy, które można by było sobie jakby przyswoić, powtarzać i mieć pewność, że to jest właśnie esencja. Więc oprócz Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, która jest dość skomplikowaną pozycją i wymaga, myślę, że jakiejś pomocy, jeśli chodzi o studiowanie, ze względu na uszczegółowienie treści, są takie prace, jak na przykład dość krótka rzecz pod tytułem Vaishnava Siddhanta Mala, Bhaktivinoda Thakura, gdzie w bardzo krótki, punktowy sposób wypisane są podstawowe prawdy wiszmuizmu. A praca była przygotowana na użytek ludzi zachodu. Więc jeśli ktoś czyta Madhurya Kadambini, a nie sięgną do Vaishnava Siddhanta Mala, to polecam, pytam, czy Maharaj polecam. Ja myślę, że tak.
Okay.